Good evening. Good evening again. Tonight we're going to talk about the antitypical Day of Atonement, not just simply the concept of the Day of Atonement, but the antitypical Day of Atonement, coming to grips with terms and its early historical development in Adventism. I want to begin by looking at three phrases or terms today. The first one is the Day of Atonement. Sometimes we refer to this as the final atonement. But sometimes in Adventism, if we look at this term theologically, the second term, the final atonement, sometimes it refers or can be referring to the final part of the Day of Atonement. The Day of Atonement is a process, and this concept of the final atonement, specifically that I want to address a good bit, is dealing with the very last events of this Day of Atonement. The next one is something called the cleansing of the sanctuary. The cleansing of the sanctuary. Into 2,300 days, then shall the sanctuary be cleansed. Daniel 8:14. And then the third phrase I'd like to look at today is called the investigative judgment. The investigative judgment. I'd like to propose kindly that the term pre-Advent judgment is never used in inspiration. The term post-Reformation judgment is never used in inspiration, but investigative judgment is. Is it a pre-Advent judgment? Yes. Is it a post-Reformation judgment? Yes, of course. Those are correct. But they fail to put the emphasis, friends, where the emphasis is put by inspiration. And we must not miss that. And my big question to you tonight is, are all these three the same thing?
They intertwine.
They certainly do, don't they? Are there differences, or does one fit into the subset of another? And I hope by the end of Saturday night that we'll have a better handle on this as well. In 1831, an atheist-turned Baptist minister by the name of William Miller began his public presentations upon the nearness of the coming of Jesus Christ, basing his predictions upon what verse? Particularly? Daniel 8:14. He predicted that Christ was soon to come. And he, in fact, made his earliest prediction that Christ would come in the year 1843. Now, tonight, I'm going to be using statements from the Spirit of Prophecy as what I believe are, and I hope you will also, an inspired historical record of sacred history. Sacred history that is being written right now. Amen. The fifth book of what we call the New Testament is what? The Acts of the Apostles. But I'd like to propose to you that while that part of the story of the Acts of the Apostles is done as far as its canonization, the history of the Acts of the Apostles should still be being written today.
Yes.
And sacred history and sacred happenings are happening today and have been happening and will be happening. Anyhow, Ellen White, she traces this down to her hearing of William Miller preach. And she says this: in March 1840, William Miller visited Portland, Maine, and gave his first course of lectures on the second coming of Christ. These lectures produced a great sensation. I'd like to say, not the kind of Pentecostal sensation you think of sometimes when you think of sensationalism in churches. She says, and the Christian church at Casco Street, occupied by Mr. Miller, was crowded day and night. Now, we've had some meetings here, and this is probably the most crowded meeting we've had today. And we had some meetings a little bit earlier. It weren't quite so crowded, isn't that right? But these meetings, they brought people in day and night, and they were crowded. It goes on to say, no wild excitement attended these meetings, but a deep solemnity pervaded the minds of those who heard his discourses. Not only was there manifested a great interest in the city, but the country people flocked in day after day, bringing their lunch baskets and remaining from morning until the closing of the evening meeting. I suppose today we would say they brought their coolers, you know, and all their goodies in. She continues, in company with my friends, I attended these meetings and listened to the startling announcement that Christ was coming in 1843. Only a few short years in the future. Mr. Miller traced the prophecies with an exactness that struck conviction into the hearts of his hearers. He dwelt upon the prophetic periods and brought many proofs to strengthen his position. Then his solemn and powerful appeals and admonitions to those who were unprepared held the crowds as if spellbound. Miller and others later revised this time to the spring of 1844. And finally, in October prior to October, they came to the conclusion that the time was October 22, 1844, that this most closely corresponded to the typical Day of Atonement in the Jewish calendar. Ellen White again supplies the history. She says, in explaining Daniel 8:14 and the 2,300 days, then shall the sanctuary be cleansed. Miller, as has been stated, adopted the generally received view that the earth is the sanctuary. And he believed that the cleansing of the sanctuary represented the purification of the earth by fire at the coming of the Lord. When, therefore, he found that the close of the 2,300 days was definitely foretold, he concluded that this revealed the time of the second advent. His error resulted from accepting the popular view as to what constitutes the sanctuary. Now, on October 22, 1844, there was what we today call this great expectation of Jesus coming, and it was followed by something we call the great disappointment. The great disappointment actually didn't happen until that night, but there was a great disappointment, and people began to look for other answers. And William Miller himself never progressed on that view of the sanctuary. But on October 23, 1844, Hiram Edson was inspired to consider that the sanctuary to be cleansed was not the earth nor any man-made temple, but rather the temple in heaven of which Moses had built a pattern. In fact, let's just turn to Hebrews chapter 8 for a minute.
What chapter?
Hebrews chapter 8. Sorry for not being clear. Hebrews chapter 8. Paul begins by saying, now of the things which we have spoken, this is the sum. When you have a summation, that means you're adding up the parts that have come prior. And to really get the full context, we would need to read the first seven chapters of Hebrews. But we don't have to take that time fully tonight, because Paul says, here's the summation of it. We're giving the summary of it. Okay? And he says, we have such an high priest who is set on the right hand of the throne of the majesty in the heavens, a minister of the sanctuary and the true tabernacle, which the Lord pitched and not man. For every high priest is ordained to offer gifts and sacrifices, wherefore it is of necessity that this man have somewhat also to offer. Verse 4. For if he were on earth, he should not be a priest, seeing that there are priests that offer gifts according to the law. Verse 5. Who serve unto the example and shadow of heavenly things. As Moses was admonished of God when he was about to make the tabernacle, for see, saith he, that thou make all things according to the pattern shewed to thee in the mount. Moses saw something in the mount. He saw a pattern or a shadow. If I'm standing under a strong light, my body will cast a shadow. The shadow is not me. The shadow is merely an outline of me. It gives a representation of something that I look like, but it's not me. If I have a blueprint of a house, it's not the house. But it shows me what the house is going to look like. It gives me a design of how to build a house. Moses was given a blueprint, if you please, of something that was in heaven, except just like when I used to build model cars, I would build these model cars, model airplanes maybe, you know, especially model airplanes, and you would get the model and it would say like 1/32nd scale. That meant for every 32 feet that the real airplane was, this one would be 1 foot long. It was a 1:32 scale. So we realize that this sanctuary that Moses was to build was a scale model of the realities of heaven. Because after all, in Daniel chapter 7, you read there that there's a movement where the Son of Man is brought before the Ancient of Days and judgment was set. And we know that this is the setting of 1844. Isn't that right? Don't you believe that? Can you say amen? Isn't that right? And the Bible says that thousands times thousands and 10,000 times 10,000 were there. And I don't know how many you could put in the earthly tabernacle, but you couldn't have put that many in, right? I mean, we would consider this heavenly sanctuary like some colossal sports arena stadium size. It's got to be huge, friends. But what was on earth was a type or a shadow of a heavenly reality. It's a very real thing. It's just as real as we are in every possible respect. Now, Adventism came up with this concept that this cleansing of the sanctuary, Daniel 8:14, involved not just the earth, or not just an earthly sanctuary, but the sanctuary in heaven. And this ran counter, and runs counter, to the prevailing view among most evangelical Protestants today. In fact, if you were to ask most evangelical Protestants about this, it is something that is considered and is thought about in evangelical literature. If you look up commentaries on Daniel 8:14, you'll read there that they believe it's talking about the cleansing of the sanctuary. But what do they mean? They believe, for the most part, that it was to be the cleansing of Zerubbabel's temple built after the time of Daniel. In fact, Smith, in his book The Major Prophets from an Old Testament Survey Series, gives this graph. And he says that this cleansing of the sanctuary of Daniel 8, it involved the persecutions of Antiochus and the cleansing of the temple, the desecration that you can read about in Maccabees and in history. And this is just about 2,300 evening and mornings, or 6 years and 4 months. Now, you notice here, one thing is that they don't use the day for year principle at all, right? But the other thing is, if you look at these dates, for instance, the death of Antiochus, they have it as 163. Most historians list it as 164. Okay. But the problem is, no matter how they slice and dice it, it never comes up exactly 2,300 days. They just say it's an approximate 2,300 days. It never fits exactly, no matter who does the math, working these systems. But you know what, friends? We have a system that works exactly with the math. Exactly. And I'm so thankful for it. The Matthew Henry Commentary on the Whole Bible, Complete and Unabridged, in Volume 1, page 1449, gives a similar view that Smith gives here. The cleansing of the sanctuary, in Adventist concept, though, expanded to include, but not restricted to, the concept of an investigative judgment. Now, would anyone like to venture a guess that of when the concept of this investigative judgment, not just simply the cleansing of the sanctuary now, but the investigative judgment, when did that occur first in Adventism? Anybody have a guess or a knowledge of it, maybe? Wouldn't you like to find out? On December the 17th, 1856, a brother by the name of Elon Everts wrote a letter to the Review. Now, about this time, Everts was traveling with Josiah Hart and James and Ellen White. And they were helping to take Elder and Sister White by sleigh to Round Grove, Illinois, and then to Waukon, Iowa. Before they could go to Waukon, they were blocked by snowdrifts for several days at Greenville, Illinois. Later, they went to Waukon, where Ellen White found a man by the name of J.N. Loughborough working on a roof. And do you remember what she said to Elder Loughborough? She said, "What doest thou here, Elijah?" And as he seemed to be speechless, she said, "What doest thou here, Elijah?" And finally she says, "What doest thou here, Elijah?" And Loughborough says that was about Christmas time that happened. But it's interesting that at this very time, Everts was traveling with the Whites. And as they traveled together, it's very probable that they discussed ideas and a special point of interest on which Everts dwelt in this letter that he wrote to the Review was actually became written for publication. And that letter began as thus: "Dear brethren, I am passing through a solemn train of thought. The question with me is, where are we? I answer, more than 12 years past the proclamation, the hour of his judgment is come," Revelation 14, 6 and 7. "We have been the same length of time in the cleansing of the sanctuary," Daniel 8:14. And this is the letter that was published January 1 of 1857 at the Review. Now remember, we noted that it was the letter itself was dated December the 17th. And then Elder White publishes it in the Review. And Everts continues. He says, "I inquire, what was the cleansing of the sanctuary under the first covenant? It was the day of judgment. What did it typify? The work in the antitypical sanctuary, which has been going on since AD 1844. Now, again, what is the antitypical sanctuary? Simply, the heavenly. It's the real thing. It's anti means it's against or not. It's not the type, it's the reality. Building upon this, Everts then stated the logical conclusion that, therefore, my dear brethren, believing that Christ will soon come, I inquire again, where are we? I answer, in the judgment of the saints. For Peter says, the judgment first begins at the house of God. Chapter 4:17. It appears that the order is that the righteous dead have been under investigative judgment since 1844. Ellen Everts, Review and Herald, January 1, 1857. This is where we find this first concept of the investigative judgment articulated in Adventism. Now, who was one of his traveling companions in December? Elder White, that's right. So arriving back in Battle Creek, James White wrote an editorial of 4.5 columns, which he entitled The Judgment. And he published this at the end of the month of January, on the 29th of January of 1857. And he used copious Bible verses to substantiate his position, and he dealt broadly with the subject. And let me just share with you some of what he wrote. It appears that the saints are judged while some are living and others are dead. To place the investigative judgment of the saints after the resurrection of the just supposes the possibility of a mistake in the resurrection, hence the necessity of an investigation to see if all who were raised were really worthy of the first resurrection. But the fact that all who have part in that resurrection are blessed and holy shows that decision is passed on all the saints before the second coming of Christ. Now let me just pause a second. Where in the Bible does it call those people in that resurrection blessed and holy? Revelation chapter... Well, yeah, somewhere in there, right. Yeah. Okay. Oh, thank you. Ever White saw a distinction between the forgiveness of sins and the blotting out of sins. And he wrote this, when are sins blotted out? Is it at the time when they are forgiven? We think not. We must look, and let me just pause for a second. When he says, we think not, was he running counter to virtually the whole Christian world when he said that? Yes. He was, absolutely. But friends, that's exactly what the Bible teaches. He was exactly right. He says, we must look to the great day of atonement as the time when Jesus offers his blood for the blotting out of sin. It is at the time of the cleansing of the sanctuary. See, he's bringing some of these terms together, but he's not necessarily saying they're all the same thing. Tying the investigative judgment in with the message to the Laodicean church, Elder White said this, it is most remarkable to conclude that there is a special call to the remnant and a special work to be performed by them and for them, preparatory to the decisions of the judgment in regard to them, and that their salvation depends upon fully obeying the calls and counsel to them. And we most solemnly believe that this preparatory call and work is brought to view in the testimony to the Laodiceans and parallel portions of the Word of God. Now, Ellen White soon began to teach on this concept. In a recently released manuscript dated June of 1857. What date? June 1857. When was Elder White writing? January 1857. When had probably he and Brother Everts been discussing this? December 1856. So we have this statement now from Ellen White. I saw, and this is the first time to my knowledge that I can find anywhere where Ellen White uses the term investigative judgment. She says, I saw, wait a minute. Yeah. I saw a crow today, or I saw a horse today, you know, no big deal, right? But when Ellen White is writing about these kind of heavenly realities. And she said, I saw. That means she received information under inspiration, doesn't it?
Amen.
I believe that. She says, I saw. We are in the investigative judgment. Soon judgment will be pronounced on our works and our actions which are passing in review before God. A solemn, awful period. Who realized this great work? I saw that those who do not now appreciate, study, and dearly prize the word of God spoken by His servants will have cause to mourn bitterly. And let me just pause for a minute. If you look at the second sentence, soon judgment will be pronounced on our works and our actions. She's writing in the present tense. She's writing with the expectation that she is going to be among a group of people who are alive when Jesus comes, and they're going to be judged, and they're going to be judged soon in 1857. That's what she's saying. She continues, I saw that the Lord in judgment will, at the close of time, walk through the earth. The fearful plagues will begin to fall. Then those who have despised God's word. Well, you've not done that, right? You don't despise God's word, do you? We wouldn't do that, would we, Terry? No. She says, then those who have despised God's word, comma, those who have lightly esteemed it. And I'd like to say, friends, if we are not able to give a study on Daniel 8:14, possibly we have lightly esteemed it, because that is the text of Adventism. It's not John 17:3. It's Daniel 8:14. No text is unimportant, but friends, Daniel 8:14 is Adventism.
Amen.
And we cannot afford to lightly esteem it. She says, those who have lightly esteemed it shall wander from sea to sea and from north even to the east. They shall run to and fro to seek the word of God and shall not find it. A famine is in the land for hearing the word. Remember in Hosea chapter 8, 11, he says that there is a famine. She says the ministers of God will have done their last work, offered their last prayers, shed their last bitter tear for a rebellious church and an ungodly people. Their last solemn warning has been given. And this is what Ellen White wrote in the year 1857. And she was writing with the possibility that she and others living at that time were going to be part of this judgment while they were alive. Isn't that what she's writing? The language is clear. Now, in her book, The Great Controversy, Ellen White connects the investigative judgment with more than a judgment in heaven, with the records of the sins being removed, but also from the removal of sin from the soul temple. Because it's not just enough, friends, to have a record changed. It doesn't change the reality of a person just to change their record. I might have a student in school, and that student makes failing marks all the way through, doesn't learn his lessons. But he goes and he takes an eraser, and he erases the grade, or he changes the F to look like an A, and he has a different grade. But he doesn't have a different mind. He hasn't changed his learning in any way. And just because a record can be changed, friends, of itself, doesn't mean our hearts are changed.
That's right.
In Great Controversy, and this is actually the 1884 edition as well as the 1911 edition. It says, while the investigative judgment is going forward in heaven, while the sins of the penitent believers are being removed from the sanctuary, there is to be a special work of purification, of putting away of sin among God's people upon the earth. This work is more clearly presented in the messages of Revelation 14. Now this judgment, it includes all who can be grouped into different groups. As Peter notes, judgment begins with the house of God, and Ellen White, she expands on that. And I think I had this from the 1911, but the 1884 or 1888 Great Controversy, it says the same thing. In the typical service, only those who had come before God with confession and repentance, and whose sins, through the blood of the sin offering, were transferred to the sanctuary, had a part in the service of the Day of Atonement. Please carefully note these next words. So in the great day of final atonement and investigative judgment, the only cases considered are those of the professed people of God. The judgment of the wicked is a distinct and separate work and takes place at a latter period. Judgment must begin at the house of God, and if it first begin at us, what shall the end be of them that obey not the gospel, according to 1 Peter 4:17, as also Everett's did and others. And the reason I make a point of saying that this is also in the 1888 Great Controversy is I want you to understand that in the timeline, in the chronological timeline of her progression of thought, this is where she was at, not just simply in 1911, but in 1888. Now, we've looked at two different groups of people here. We've looked at those who profess to believe Jesus, right? Those who've made a profession, they all their names come up in this investigative judgment, right? And the other group are those who have never professed to believe in anything, and they are by default judged at another later time, we're told. But there's another group. And this grouping is a subset of those who professed to be believers. And this subset now is the group of those who are living and those who are dead. And I think that our Brother Carter touched on this a little bit earlier today, wherever he's at. I don't see him now. But obviously, we believe the dead are to be judged before the living. I think everyone's in agreement on that. But can we know when the righteous living will be judged, or has it already begun? And we want to notice the progression of theological thought from Ellen White on this. Very early, Ellen White had wrote, as we noted earlier, these words, and I'll just read them again. I saw we are in the investigative judgment. Soon judgment will be pronounced on our works and our actions, which are passing in review before God. And that was written in 1857. Do you remember the month? June, 1857, right. Her next major pronouncement would not come for almost 30 years. And this is found in what we call Volume 4, The Spirit of Prophecy. And it was written in 1884. And here's what she says. Solemn are the scenes connected with the closing work of the atonement. Momentous are the interests therein involved. The judgment is now passing in the sanctuary above. 40 years has this work been in progress. Remember, she's writing this in 1884, 40 years from 1844. Soon, now here's the key, soon, none know how soon, it will pass to the cases of the living. In the awful presence of God, our lives are to come up in review. At this time, above all others, it behooves every soul to heed the Savior's admonition. Watch and pray, for ye know not when the time is. Watch ye therefore, lest coming suddenly he find you sleeping. Mark 13, 33, 35, and 36. And that's found in Spirit of Prophecy, Volume 4. Pages 314, 315, and again written in 1884. She says, soon, none know how soon, this judgment is going to pass from the dead to the living. And she says, therefore, it behooves every one of us, every soul, to heed the Savior's warnings. And so in 1884, Ellen White knew that the judgment might pass to the living, but she gives no indication if she knew exactly when or what signs might indicate it happened, or when it would happen. And in fact, writing in 1886, she freely admits that she knew neither the time or a sign by which we might know. Writing to Elder George Butler from Switzerland, she said this, "Humble your souls before God. Jesus is in the sanctuary. We are in the great day of atonement, and if the investigative judgment has not already commenced for the living, it will soon begin. And to how many are the words of the true witness applicable? I know thy works, that thou hast a name, that thou livest and art dead. Be watchful and strengthen the things which remain that are ready to die, for I have not found thy works perfect before God. Remember therefore how thou hast received and heard, and hold fast and repent. If therefore thou shalt not watch, I will come on thee as a thief, and thou shalt not know what hour I shall come upon thee." And again, this was written in 1886, dated September the 6th. She was in Basel, Switzerland, writing to Elder George Butler. But if I could just go back one slide, please. She says here that if the investigative judgment is not already commenced for the living, it will soon begin. She's saying, I don't know. I don't know if it's begun or not. I think it will be soon if it hasn't, but maybe it already has. She herself at that time did not know. Now, don't think that is in any way derogatory to think that. After all, many biblical prophets have not understood their own revelations. And particularly, I think we think of Daniel. Daniel needed understanding about this Mara and this Kazon, right? Sure. At this point, again, she doesn't know if the judgment of the living has occurred at that very moment or not. But her next statement came concerning her letter to Butler in 1886, of which she commented upon in 1889. So she wrote this letter to Butler in 1886. But now in 1889, she's going to make another comment. And it was similar to what we read in Spirit Prophecy, Volume 4. She said this. This is found in Testimonies for the Church, Volume 5, page 692. Several times during the past winter, referring to the winter of 1888 through 1889, I have met the report that during the conference at Minneapolis, quote, Sister White was shown that the judgment, which since 1844 had been passing upon the righteous dead, had now begun upon the living, end quote. This report is not true. A similar rumor, which has been afloat for about 2 years, originated in this wise. In a letter written from Basel, Switzerland, to a minister in California, I made a remark substantially as follows. Now, she's making reference to letter 51 of 1886 that she wrote to George Butler. And she says, substantially this. She puts it in quote marks, but she doesn't say exactly this. She may not have had the letter in front of her, but she says, this is substantially what I said. The judgment has been over 40 years in progress on the cases of the dead, and we know not how soon it will pass to the cases of the living. The letter was read to different persons, and careless hearers reported what they thought they heard. And if I may pause for a minute.
Do you have this question?
I'm sorry. I didn't fast forward it. I'm sorry. There we go. Yes. Thank you. The judgment, she says, has been going on for over 40 years in progress on the cases of the dead, if we know not how soon it will pass to the cases of the living. Now that's what she's saying in 1889 in Testimonies, Volume 5. So she's saying, I substantially was writing this in the letter, because at that time that letter was not public knowledge. That letter hadn't been published, you see. And she says, the letter was read to different persons, and careless hearers reported what they thought they heard. And this is what the part I want to pause on. Thank you for giving me the advance that, by the way. How oftentimes do we carelessly hear something? And then all of a sudden, you know, doctrinal fact goes out. You know, or personal fact goes out. You know, do you know what Brother Allen did? I saw Brother Allen with a Coca-Cola bottle today. I had a Coca-Cola bottle today. It was going to be part of my science experiment we didn't get to have. You know, but someone could have taken that the wrong way if they saw me. I tried to be very careful, you know, I didn't want anyone to get the wrong idea. But here's the problem, friends. It hasn't ceased to be a problem. We have careless hearers. But Jesus said, take heed what you hear. Be careful what you hear and listen and pay attention. Mark 4:24. She says, thus the matter started. The report from Minneapolis arose from someone's misunderstanding of a statement to the effect as the one quoted from the letter. There is no other foundation for either report than this. And that was her next pronouncement on this issue. But it wasn't her last. Sometime within a year, she received a revelation. And she wrote to a brother, J.M. Garman, and his wife, who had claimed that their daughter Annie was having visions and dreams. And in her letter of correction to the brother and sister, she noted this. You say that Annie's visions place the forming of the image of the beast after probation closes. This is not so. You claim to believe the testimonies. Let them set you right on this point. Now notice. Something's changed in this last year. Because instead of not being informed, instead of not knowing one way or the other, the Lord has shown me. And the Lord has not only shown her something, she says, the Lord has shown me clearly that the image of the beast... Wait a minute, what does that have to do with what we're talking about? You're going to see, just listen. The Lord has shown me clearly that the image of the beast will be formed before probation closes, for it is to be the great test for the people of God by which their eternal destiny will be sealed. It says decided, but sealed. That's the concept, isn't it?
In 7 BC, 976.
Okay, thank you. In other words, this was written, as I said, to Brother and Sister Garmin, who believed their daughter was having visions. And you notice the date is 1890. It's also in Selected Messages. We have a reference from 7 in the commentary and so on. But she says here that there's a test for the people of God that's going to decide their eternal destiny. Friends, if we were in the judgment of the living right now, and someone was judged yesterday who's in the judgment of the living, but they haven't had the test that's going to decide their eternal destiny yet, something's wrong. Does that make sense? In other words, there's something about this formation, the image of the beast, that involves the people who are alive in the end of time. And they're going to be judged as those who are in the living are going to be judged at that time based upon how they respond to that test. And I think it's interesting that in Great Controversy on page 445, she says that this image of the beast represents that form of apostate Protestantism which will be developed when the Protestant churches shall seek the aid of the civil power for the enforcement of their dogmas. And we know that very specifically and most pinpointedly, this is talking about the observance of Sunday sacredness. You can go into Pineville, for instance, and on our county courthouse yard, there's a copy of what is called the Anointed Ten Commandments of God. But just go and read the fourth commandment. It says nothing about the seventh day in it. Nothing. But we realize that this is going to be the great test that's going to come upon the people of God, and it's a test of whether we really know our God or not. Because it's only going to be the people who know their God that are going to be strong and do exploits at that time. And if we don't have this bedrock fundamental relationship with God and with Christ at that time, we're not going to be able to stand that test, friends. And we will be found wanting as part of the judgment of the living at that time. I believe clearly why we are on the threshold of such events. We are not there yet. But we're on the threshold. It's just around the corner. But we have understanding, and we have understood the working of God in Christ in heaven better than anybody else. But friends, I just really wondered, on an individual level, where are we at? Do we have this understanding we should have? In Psalm 77 and 13, Thy way, O God, is in the sanctuary. Do we appreciate what this means and what's going on in heaven and how God has led us as a people, friends? You see, the sanctuary doctrine today, you ask Adventists, do we teach a sanctuary doctrine? Of course we teach a sanctuary doctrine. We believe in a pre-Advent judgment. We don't believe in an investigative judgment anymore. No, no. We don't believe in a doctrine of sanctification and perfection like we used to. We don't. And you think that the truth about God is the only major fundamental that's been changed in the fundamental beliefs of the Seventh-day Adventist Church, and that's entirely wrong. We have changed the sanctuary doctrine. We have rewritten it to equal the teachings of the book Questions on Doctrine. We'll talk about that more tomorrow night, Lord willing. But we need to understand these things better. What we need to have a better conception of is how this Day of Atonement and the cleansing of the sanctuary is investigative judgment. We need to understand how these things fit together. They're not all the same thing. These are subsets. The cleansing of the sanctuary, investigative judgment, is a subset of this great Day of Atonement, or the final atonement. And the investigative judgment is a part of this cleansing of the sanctuary, which is a part of the Day of Atonement. Now, I think Brother Andy read you a statement. I'm going to read it to you again tonight. He read this last night. The subject of the sanctuary and the investigative judgment should be clearly? Does it say that? Clearly understood by who? Oh, let me just stop for a minute. Do you believe you're part of the remnant? If you don't, you better get it into being part of the remnant, right? If we don't really believe we're that people, then we better get to be that people. And if we don't clearly understand these subjects, if we don't have a conceptual understanding of these things, then it's time that we do. She says, all need a knowledge for themselves not for me, not for someone else, but for themselves, of the position and work of their great high priest. Otherwise, it will be impossible. And that's a big word. It will be impossible for them to exercise the faith which is essential at this time, or to occupy the position which God designs them to fill. Let me just pause there. She doesn't say that you might lose salvation, friends. But she says you won't be doing what God wants you to do. You see what I'm saying? I'm not going to read into the statement something that's not there. It's easy to do, isn't it? We can read a statement and we pontificate on it. The statement doesn't say you'll lose your salvation. But it does say that it will be impossible to exercise the faith which is essential at this time, or to occupy the position which God designs them to fill. And that could be salvational. It goes on to say this. Every individual has a soul to save or to lose. Each has a case pending at the bar of God. Each must meet the great judge face to face. How important, then, that every mind contemplate often the solemn scene when the judgment shall sit and the books shall be opened, when with Daniel every individual must stand in his lot at the end of the days. Friends, it is time to be a student now. Because remember, we read earlier that those who have despised God's word, well, we haven't done that, we said. But those who have maybe lightly esteemed it shall wander from sea to sea and from north even to the east, and they shall run to and fro and seek the word of the Lord and shall not find it. And so, Brother Allen, you don't know how many of those newsletters I get, and I read them all. You don't know how many of those videos I download, and I watch them all. And I'm amazed at how many people who do those things who don't know anything. And they download and they receive material that especially does not support the truth about God. That does not support the truth about the investigative judgment. But you know, it sure exposes the Masons well. It sure talks about the Illuminati a lot. Friends, that's not what we need today. That's not what we need today. You know, John says that they don't bring this truth of the Father and Son. Don't bid them, don't invite them into your house, and don't bid them Godspeed. But you know, they send me these things, so I'm going to give them some money this month, you know, right? You want to know why sometimes we get so confused, friends? It's because we listen to everything coming and going, and we don't take heed what we hear. We're not careful to listen only to truth. Amen. Now I know, the Bible says, prove all things, hold fast that which is good. But friends, once I prove something, do I have to keep reproving it over and over and over? God forbid. God save us from such things. We've got too much truth. Too much salvational truth to study at this time, this late hour. And to understand better. And not be confused. And not have an amalgamated faith which has part of historic Adventism and part of new theology blended together. And it's out there. There's a lot of it. I'm going to tell you, there's a lot of it. And we don't have time for it. And you don't have time for it. And God doesn't have time for it. And you may think I'm harsh about this, but I'm going to tell you, friends, there's going to come a day in the judgment. And it is coming soon. And the judgment's going to pass to the living because we're going to be tested in a way we've never been tested before. And if we're not ready, you kiss a goodbye, friends. Kiss a goodbye. We're going to find out how cheap we sold out for.